to share my heart. When I want to face something,
I'll call you. I'm up.
It's him again.
Him who?
Go to church with you.
We don't care what you wear. Our pastor is funny. We won't ask for money.
Who even uses a boombox anymore?
Yeah, I'll say anything to get us to go to church.
I want to see you at my church.
Today we're talking about inviting people to church, to Easter. That's like next week, friends. We want to revive your invite. Now here's what we're going to talk about today. What we're inviting to, why we're inviting, who we're inviting, and how we're inviting. I mean, it's been hard to invite anybody to anything over the last 2 years. There's such a wide variety of people's comfort levels with being in groups, being indoors, being outdoors. I mean, at this point, I've had 2 shots. I've been boosted. I've had COVID. So I'm pretty much comfortable anywhere I go. But I'm not representative of every single person. The experts tell us that we're moving from a pandemic to an endemic and that we're just having to learn to live with this thing for, who knows, the foreseeable future. But as we go into this endemic stage of COVID, there's a dynamic spectrum of caution. I mean, some people are okay doing inside events. Some people want to do outside events only. Some people want to wear a mask indoors, and some people are ready for masks to be a thing of the past. It's like the whole rhythm of our lives has been put in a blender and it's just gotten destroyed.
Wow!
So nobody knows what they're doing or when they're doing it or whether they want to do it together or not. So here's a question for you. Turn to somebody next to you if you're in the room, or if you're online, comment in the chat section. What's been your experience over these last 2 years, the positive and the negative, of inviting people to, well, really anything? What we're going to start talking about today is what exactly you're inviting to. I mean, there's at best like a misperception of what church is, and at worst, a real awareness of some of the abuses of church out there. I think about this one guy that I came across on YouTube who puts stuff to kind of heavy metal music. And here he is, he's sitting at the kitchen table watching this church TV preacher with his kid playing Duplos, and he starts thinking about, what if this was, well, a heavy metal concert? And here's what happens.
I execute judgment on you, COVID-19. Oh. I execute judgment on you, Satan. You destroyer. You killer. You get out. You break your power. You get off this nation. I demand judgment on you.
So sometimes our first problem is just helping people know that that is not what church is like. Well, except maybe the heavy metal part. COVID temps have gone high, but what that's done to our invitational temperature is it's dropped it into a polar plunge. Listen, I get it. It's been hard. It's been hard for me to invite, but we got to get our temperature back up. We've got to revive our invite. Now, here's the good news. You attend a church that offers all kinds of options to invite people to. I mean, we got outdoor events, we got indoor events, masks are optional, we got online stuff. We got a party in Potterville, we got a party in South Lansing. I mean, let's take a look at each of our campuses and what they're doing. Here's what Potterville looks like. Starting on Wednesday night, we've got a Living Last Supper at 7 p.m. And then on Thursday, we're gonna serve the community with a free car wash at Mr. Clean in Potterville. Come serve your community from 5 to 7 p.m. Easter egg hunt on Saturday at Potterville Park at 10 a.m. I mean, you can't do a better Easter egg hunt than what we're doing in Potterville with the community involved. A little later on Saturday evening at 2 p.m. is our Holy Saturday Spirit Service, free tacos at Sanctuary Spirits. I mean, who doesn't want free tacos? On Sunday morning, we've got a community Easter sunrise service at 7 a.m. at Lake Alliance Park, and pets are welcome. And then we got our normal Easter services on Sunday, 9 a.m. online and 10:30 in person. That's the party of Potterville, friends. And it doesn't matter whether you live in Potterville or not. You can go to any of that kind of stuff, and you can invite people to it. But here's the party at South Lansing. On Friday night, April 15th, we got Good Friday in a garage, poetry slam, and free barbecue at my house, the Parsonage in Holt. I mean, who doesn't want free barbecue in the driveway? Invite your friends just for the free food. On Saturday morning, we've got a neighborhood Easter egg hunt with Scott Woods at 11 a.m. On Easter morning, we've got our community Easter sunrise service in Mount Hope Cemetery at 7 a.m. And pets are welcome. And then, of course, our Sunday morning Easter services at South Lansing, 10:30, both in person and online, followed by free barbecue on the patio, along with a photo booth and face painting and all kinds of fun stuff out there. We got a serious set of options to invite people to all kinds of parties at both of our campuses. Now, I keep talking about these things like they're parties, and you're probably wondering, what's a party got to do with Easter? Well, Jesus tells a story about being invited to a party. Yes, the kingdom of heaven is gonna be like a party.
You gotta fight for your right to party.
Hearing this, a man sitting at the table with Jesus exclaimed, "What a blessing it will be to attend a banquet in the kingdom of God." A banquet of blessing, a party of profit, a celebration of credit, a festivity of favor, a revelry of resources, a bash of benefits, and a gala of gain. I mean, this is the party that we're going to be throwing at Easter at Potterville and the party that we're throwing at Easter at South Lansing. And all of this is not even to get to the whole point of why we're throwing the party. That's what I want to talk about now. Why we're inviting. What exactly does Easter mean?
The word Easter literally refers to the time of year in the spring when the days become longer than the nights. But for the person who knows Jesus Christ, Easter means a lot more than that. It means that even though Jesus died, salvation didn't. Even though Jesus was buried, hope wasn't. Because Jesus is alive. Easter means there is forgiveness for my failures, grace for my guilt, and mercy for my misery. Easter means that the pain and the silence of living in a Saturday world isn't purposeless and it isn't permanent. Easter means that I can't out-sin the grace of God and I can't outrun the reach of God. It means that Jesus is King. Light overcomes darkness. And justice will win. And brokenness will be broken. Easter means that the scars on the hands of Jesus are telling a story of victory, not defeat. And the same is true for me. It means that I am not alone, not ashamed, not forgotten, and not forsaken. It means that the rain and the storms and the wind and the waves of this world will not have the last word, because my future is a resurrected body with a resurrected Jesus on a resurrected earth. Easter means that I can join with a choir of saints and angels singing, "Oh death, where is your victory? Oh grave, where is your sting? Oh hell, where is your song?" Easter means that as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed my transgressions from me. And as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for me. Easter means that even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because you are with me.
In the shadow of COVID, I think Easter means to be revived, to restore to consciousness or life. I mean, literally, we're talking about the resurrection here, but if we're honest, a lot of us need a resurrection spiritually, physically, emotionally, relationally. We need to be revived to consciousness. Revive also means to restore from a depressed, inactive, or unused state, to bring back. It's time to regain, to revive what has been lost to depression or inactivity or disuse, and to renew in the mind or memory. We're talking about being renewed, being revived this Easter. What would you say is the point of Easter or the meaning of Easter for you and for those around you? Turn to somebody you're sitting next to, or if you're online in the chat section, let us know the answer to that question. Let's talk about this. We're talking about reviving your invite, and so far we've talked about what we're inviting to, and then we talked about why we're inviting, and now we're going to talk about who you're going to invite. Jesus continues telling this story about an invitation to a party, saying, "A man prepared a great feast and sent out many invitations. And when the banquet was ready, he sent his servant to tell the guests, 'Come, the banquet is ready.'" I mean, this host of the party has what all of us have. It's got like a first list of invites. It's the expected people, the friends and family list. When you think about who you'd invite to Easter, your first list could easily just be the expected people, like the people who already belong to the church, but maybe you haven't seen them in a long time. That's like the low-hanging fruit when it comes to inviting people. Tomorrow, Monday, April 11th, we're going to gather at South Lansing, and we're going to call everybody at our South Lansing campus. It's called the Easter Phone Challenge. I mean, literally, we're going to call everybody, and you can sign up on your connection card. Now, if you're at the Potterville campus, there's no organized event that we're going to do to call everybody, but there's no reason why you can't pick up your phone and just call somebody and invite them who you haven't seen in the last year or two. Now, Jesus continues this story about being invited to a party, saying, "But they all began making excuses. One said, 'I've just bought a field and must inspect it. Please excuse me.' And another said, 'I've just bought 5 pairs of oxen and I want to try them out. Please excuse me.' And another said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.'" In this parable, there's excuses about business, about finances, about relationships, but really, all of these excuses just belie a certain set of priorities, and Jesus is kind of unmasking those priorities. Now, when you invite people to church, you're going to hear excuses. I mean, that's just how people are. Some people are going to say, "You know what? I'm not ready to be back in person in a big group of people." Well, that's okay. We've got something online. Or, "I'm just not ready to be inside with people." You know what? That's all right. We got events that are outside. "Sunday morning is my only day to sleep in." You know what? We got events at night. "I just don't agree with the beliefs of the Christian church." Well, that's okay, because we're a curious church. Your questions are welcome, and you don't have to agree with us to belong. "I'm just not that interested. I don't care. I mean, church is so boring." You've never been to a church that does things creatively. "I just don't feel welcome at church. You know, I've been hurt by the church in the past." We get that. A lot of people at Sycamore Creek have been hurt by the church in the past too, but we're a church that's compassionate. We're not going to nail this every time, but we're going to do our best to show you the compassion of God, no matter who you are or where you've been or what you've done or where we meet you. All of these excuses only end up losing out on the joy of the celebration, the banquet of blessing, the party of profit, the celebration of credit, the festivity of favor, the revelry of resources, the bash of benefits, or the gala of gain. So who's on your first list of invites to Easter? It's time to revive our invite. Now, if the people on your first list don't accept your invitation, don't worry. God's got even more invites coming. Back to the story that Jesus is telling of being invited to a party. "The servant returned and told his master what they had said. His master was furious and said, 'Go quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' The second invitation list is an invitation list that goes out to the town, the alleys, the byways. I mean, like the diversity of the invitation expands to those that you wouldn't expect to be invited to the party, the banquet, the poor, the marginalized. And people are more likely to accept invitation when they find themselves in a place of tension, transition, or trouble. There's an abundance of tension, transition, and trouble right now. I mean, there's trouble relationally. Our families are falling apart. Our marriages are falling apart. There's a tension financially. Like, we're struggling just to pay the bills. There's a tension vocationally. I mean, this whole thing about the great resignation, people changing jobs. There's so much tension, transition, and trouble right now that people are open to being invited in a way that maybe they never have been. I mean, again, these are people who never thought they'd be invited to the party, but they show up and they receive the benefits of the banquet. Joy. The banquet of blessing, the party of profit, the celebration of credit, the festivity of favor, the revelry of resources, the bash of benefits, and the gala of gain. There are some groups of people that have not traditionally felt welcomed at church. The poor and the homeless, those without resources, those in the LGBTQ community. And in many cases, the church has kept women from full participation in the church. These are the sort of invites that the story is talking about, and maybe they're invites that you want to make who are on your second list of reviving your invite. Who is on your second list of Easter invites? But if nobody accepts who's on your second list, don't worry, God has more invites. Jesus continues the story. After the servant had done this, he reported, "There is still room for more." So his master said, "Go out into the country lanes and behind the hedges and urge anyone you find to come so that the house will be full. For none of those I first invited will get even the smallest taste of my banquet." This third invitation list is an invitation list that goes out into the country, out into the highways and the byways. We're talking about a great diversity of people, people who do things differently, who have different customs and cultures. In fact, Jesus is probably originally talking about ethnic Gentiles versus ethnic Jews. The party has been opened up to all kinds of people, racially and ethnically. Now, here at South Lansing, we've been doing our best to begin to use a wide expression of different cultures and ethnicities in our worship. We've got gospel, and we've got rap and hip-hop and poets and all kinds of expressions here. And at our Potterville campus, we're also looking for ways that we can put diverse voices on the stage in front of us and engage them and listen to them. When you show up, you're going to receive the diverse benefits of the party, the banquet, the diverse joy, the banquet of blessing, the party of profit, the celebration of credit, the festivity of favor, the revelry of resources, and the bash of benefits, the gala of gain. So who is on your third list of Easter invites? Revive your invite. So here's a chat question for you. Turn to the person next to you or comment in the comment section. Who are the three people or the three categories of people that you could invite to Easter? Let's talk about that. So far, we've talked about what we're inviting to, why we're inviting, and who we're inviting. Let's talk about how we're inviting. Here's what I want to do. I want to give you three tips for how to revive your invite. And the first one is pray. You've written down three names or three categories of people, and take some time to pray. Pray that God would open the door naturally to invite them. I remember one time one of my neighbors was on my invite list, and I was praying for God to open the door to invite him. And she just had a baby, so I brought some food down. And as I was delivering the food to them, she said, "You know what? I've seen on Facebook this dad's group that you've got." And boom, there was the natural invite to invite her husband to be part of our dad's group. The second tip is to invite, pick up, and bring. I know that's three all in two, but bear with me here, okay? Once you've made the invite, actually go pick them up. Say, hey, I'll come by your house and you want to drive, and then bring them into the room. Or another way to think about this is, say, when you get here, text me or call me and I'll come meet you out in the parking lot. Do you know how awkward it is to walk into a big room of people that you don't know anybody? I mean, help overcome that awkwardness by inviting, picking up, and bringing the people that are coming to church with you on Easter. The third tip is to invest and invite. This has to be a lifestyle of investing in the people around you. I mean, your first step towards inviting somebody on this list might not be actually inviting them. It might just be investing time in them, more time in them. I mean, genuinely being interested and curious about them, genuinely showing them compassion. And so your invite may start with simply inviting them to get together for coffee or over to your house for a meal, or asking if there's anything that they need help with at their house and going and participating in helping them. Our lifestyle as Christians should be one of investing in the people around us. So invest and invite. This Easter season, we're reviving our invite. Reviving my invite, reviving your invite, reviving all of our invites together. And you are invited to invite.
Many of us hear a voice that pulls on our hearts. It's a good voice that speaks to us about the people in our lives. And it's inviting us to invite them to our church. But something prevents us from acting on it. Maybe it's the fear of what they might think. Maybe it's a feeling that we're in some way disqualified. Maybe we feel like we don't have all the answers yet, or that we don't want to put our friends on the spot. But Easter's just around the corner, and that changes the game. It's unique because most people already want to go to church on Easter. They just need to be invited. So what might happen if you asked God, who? That's it. God, who should I invite? He will answer that prayer because he's anxious to answer that prayer. We only need ears to hear. And maybe that voice has actually been his voice all along.
Again.
Hey man, can I ask you something?
Sure, what's up?